Thank you. Good morning. Well, I've been introduced already quite a bit. Basically, we're discussing copyright reform now. And if you look at the past roughly century of copyright law, it's not a very good story for the freedom of expression, the free flow of information. For the most part, copyright has been expanding, and if you look at the answers to the public consultation of the European Commission of last year, most of the what I call the content dinosaurs are clamoring for even further expansions of copyright. Of course, we should forbid linking to other content, and similar text can be found in there. It's also interesting when you look back about 100 years ago. On Project Gutenberg, you can find a PhD dissertation from 1910, which is slightly over a century ago. It's written in Dutch, so it's not very accessible to most people here. The interesting bit is it's a dissertation on copyright across Europe. And it more or less gives a very good inventory of the copyright debates following to the Berne Convention. And if you look at that inventory of arguments for copyright, you basically find most of the arguments that are being made in public about copyright right now. So for over a century, we have been running in circles. And that means that most of the problems with copyright we're discussing about are not about copyright in the digital era. Because if we're making the same arguments as people did in the late 19th century, in the very early 20th century, without the internet around us, copyright may have had problems to begin with before the internet came along. In my opinion, the internet is not a problem for copyright. The internet has only laid bare the rotten design that underlies copyright. For me, the Berne Convention from the start, especially if you look at its development later on with the addition of the three-step test in the late 60s, is a vehicle that makes it very, very difficult to discuss copyright. On one hand, you have a political climate in which is very conducive to copyright maximalism, because there's a certain level of neoliberalism that permeates the policy debate, especially at the European level. And by the way, that's not meant to demean neoliberalism too much. For a time, I identified as a neoliberal. And the idea that property rights have a strong function in to help out to preserve, especially scarce goods, is something I still strongly believe in. The problem is that scarcity may not be the right way to look at copyright. Another part of the problem with the debates surrounding copyright is that because of the Berne Convention being sort of an amalgamate of public policy arguments, you can always discuss something about copyright and someone answering along the lines of an entirely different argument. For example, when you start discussing a question like what is an optimal level of copyright, you will end up being dragged into a debate about the moral rights of authors, which may be not be the same thing. But anyway, my assumption is if you want to talk about meaningful copyright reform, and by that I mean not necessarily just discussing exceptions, and again, that's not the mean exceptions, they are a very important vehicle, we should also discuss the very core. And it would also be helpful for the debate about copyright reform to not just stick to the current model, but also give a perspective of what a future model could look like. We may not necessarily end up with that, but the debate in especially the European Parliament and outside that has often been about people that are perceived as taking away something that works, the devil you know, and not giving a true perspective on what could work the other way. And everyone, well, most people are afraid of vacuums. So it only makes sense that in reflexively policymakers will still refer to the old model. But anyway, those are some of my arguments to burn down Berne. Another argument is it's also nice to dream for a change. So what should a proper copyright look like? And I hinted to it in my introduction a little bit. I think a proper copyright should not focus too much on distribution rights. Distribution as a problem actually has been solved mostly by the internet. The only real remaining distribution problem is that of curation, and not so much about reproduction. I mean, you already have fantastic reproduction machines, and we're getting even better ones, even for physical objects nowadays. So distribution is less interesting than, for example, one of the other problems, but there's still another problem that you should decouple from copyright, and that is about remuneration for authors. It's a perfectly valid question to ask, how do we provide a living wage to professional authors or professional creators? At least it sounds like a perfectly sensible question. The question I would like to ask then is, why do we consider creators so much more special that we want to have a separate discussion about living wages for professional authors apart from a discussion about living wages for other workers? What makes a creator morally superior to a carpenter who made some furniture in a way that entitles the creator or the author to control over his work more than a carpenter has over a bit of furniture he has made or she has made, or even more so to the descendants of the author or the creator compared to a carpenter? To me, that is not a politically incorrect question to ask. But a lot of the debate about copyright is ultimately framed with a kind of hidden assumption that creators are morally superior to than other people in society. I generally do not believe that. And that's one of the reasons I believe that the debate about remuneration of artists should be kept separate from, or we should try to have a copyright that does not involve too much in that. Because ultimately the question of what a work is, the value of a work, is not something we can decide on a policy basis. There must be some room for a market in there. To move on from there, I think there's one bit in the Berne Convention that deserves salvaging, and that is the moral right, because that is about the connection between the author and the audience. And the right to be credited is an important link between the creator and the audience. And in a way, a potential idea would be to have every work to be under copyright that will be similar to today's Creative Commons share alike license. And that immediately also gives a nice upper ceiling for the duration of copyright. For the simple reason that moral rights have no good reason to survive an author. Just like dead people don't have privacy, why should there be a moral right surviving the author? As far as I understand, there's no concept of an afterlife in which the people in that afterlife are too much bothered by what's left of their reputation on this earth. I'm not saying that the duration of copyright should never be more than the life, but the duration for the moral rights should not extend the life of the author. And the last bit remaining is, I think a proper copyright should actually mirror the freedom of expression as we have enshrined it in the Human Convention of Human Rights and the Charter of Fundamental Rights. A proper copyright law should include evidence-based requirements for any change, even recurring re-evaluations of it, that explicitly acknowledge that copyright is an exception to the freedom of expression and not the other way around. I think that actually is the most perverse part of the Wörner Convention. The three-step test is in itself fundamentally incompatible with notions of freedom of expression.